Father, with the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God, the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God, the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we who fill our lives with your ideals be joined with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we perceive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, that by following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. Well, I welcome you here this morning. I didn't know what to expect today with the weather forecast. I've heard everything starting from 7 a.m. till like midday tomorrow. I heard 5 to 10. Somebody told me this morning there's a possibility of up to 14, so I'm all excited. And I did look at the long-range forecast for this upcoming week, and I added it all together, and we're talking 2 feet of snow. So our condolences to Teresa Belisle. She's heading down to Florida. Going to miss all of this. Too bad. But this is just fun. This is what New England is all about, the seasons. And I know you're not as excited as I am, but I do love my snow. So anyway, I do want to welcome Irene Morrissey, who is here visiting with us today. And if you get the electronic newsletter or bulletin, there was that little, a scanned copy of an article from the Greenfield Reporter. That was care of Irene, and it was about my little yellow car turning into my green car, and the guy all the way over in Europe, and the neighbors that didn't like those two cars. And I just thought that was a soulmate of mine over there with that yellow and green car. And once this green one here bites the dust, I talked to Joe Kostick, I'm going to look for a tangerine one. That'll be the next one. So we'll get them all. But today, I hope you did notice that the church has a different appearance. And as I mentioned, we went from, you know, the Christmas tree, the manger, and then got rid of that, and then we still had all the flowers until the end of the Epiphany season. But now we are at the point of pre-Lent. These are the 3 Sundays prior to Ash Wednesday, and they're the church's tiny little season of transition. Because, if you really get into the cycle of the liturgy, to go from the birth and the celebration of Jesus coming into our world with all that, the angels and the announcements, to then go into the talk about his death, that's a harsh transition. And so this is a transition season, and we start introducing one Lenten hymn, we start introducing the purple, the Gloria is out of the Mass, but it is still also some of that general theme of an ordinary time. And so we kind of combine the two to make the psychological transition of the liturgical season just a little bit easier. So this is the first of the 3 pre-Lenten Sundays, and then we do get into Ash Wednesday, Great Lent, and all the way up to the unbelievable mystery of God's love that is the cross. So as we do enter into Mass at this time, for those who will be receiving communion, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience. And may we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow. suffered and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for you to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And our you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, the purity of heart, we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice.
Amen.
And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power for all time, now, and forever. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty Father, you filled us with knowledge and understanding, and showed us the difference between good and evil. May we live according to your holy word, see the splendor of your majesty, and hear the glory of your voice. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Taken from St. Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who loved him, these things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. No one experiencing temptation should say, I am being tempted by God. For God is not subject to temptation, to evil, and he himself tempts no one. If you love me, cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, as you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. Jesus said, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. Truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter or the smallest part of a letter will pass from the law until all things have taken place. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do so will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever obeys and teaches these commandments will be called greatest in the kingdom of heaven. I tell you, unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. You have heard that it was said to your ancestors, you shall not kill, and whoever kills will be liable to judgment. But I say to you, whoever is angry with his brother or sister will be liable to judgment, and whoever says to his brother, Raca, which means fool, will be answerable to the Sanhedrin. Whoever says you fool will be liable to a fiery Gehenna. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there recall that your brother or sister has anything against you, leave your gift there at the altar. Go first to be reconciled with your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Settle with your opponent quickly while on the way to court with him or her. Otherwise, your opponent will hand you over to the judge, and the judge will hand you to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I say to you, you will not be released until you have paid every last penny. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than to have your whole body thrown into Gehenna. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than to have your whole body go into Gehenna. It is also said, whoever divorces his wife must give her a bill of divorce. But I say to you, whoever divorces his wife, unless the marriage is unlawful, causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to your ancestors, do not take a false oath, but make good to the Lord all that you vow. But I say to you, do not swear at all, not by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, nor by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Do not swear by your head, for you cannot make a single hair white or black. Let instead your yes be yes, and your no be no. Anything more than this is evil. This is the gospel of the Lord.
So it takes a certain amount of faith to pray to Jesus and he kinds of dire situations where everything seems lost and defeat almost seems certain. And I know those games can be really, really important to a lot of people. And I don't think God works this way, but it sure looks like something happened towards the end of that game. Either one of those two front pages from the Globe, they could have been true. The Florida one about loss or the Boston one about victory, either one could have been true. But somehow, maybe by your prayers, the Patriots did get their next Super Bowl ring. But as world-shaking as that game was, Jesus's "But I Say to You" defines our souls and our very relationship with God Himself. Jesus begins today by recognizing the sacred importance of everything in the faith that came before Him. "I have come not to abolish the law nor the prophets," He says. But then, just after He says that, He goes on to change them nonetheless. And the only authority by which He does so is the authority of His very own person. "But I say to you." Think about what that means. There is the established tradition defined, you know, by history and tradition, and it is there from generation to generation, and it is there is something as broad-reaching in all of society as murder, what to do about the murder. It is as intimate as marriage. How do you treat somebody whose marriage is coming to an end? It is private, it's private as somebody's word, their honor. So it covers everything from the broadness of society down right down to the individual and his word. And this tradition was accepted, it was practiced, it was reverenced, and it was believed to come from God. And then, at the very beginning of his ministry, when very few people knew about him, when very few people had seen any of his miracles, and maybe those people on the Sermon on the Mount, maybe they had never seen any miracle at all, this fellow from Galilee, this carpenter's son, he starts to preach and he says, "But I say to you." I cannot overemphasize how astounding this must have been, and it still remains. He was confronting people with a choice of faith that wouldn't determine something like a football game between the Falcons and the Patriots. Jesus was confronting people and how they actually saw God. And could they see God in the voice and the person of this carpenter's son? It is only the ones who could hear and accept the voice of God in Jesus who then had any chance of becoming the first Christians. It was a commitment to his person. Only those who somehow developed a direct connection to Jesus as he spoke, who felt the presence of God somehow when Jesus was near, who felt somehow different whenever Jesus was there in the room, who could then accept his authority to say, "But I say to you." Who was this carpenter who could say, "But I say to you," and challenge Moses coming off of Mount Sinai with two stone tablets written by the finger of God, and this carpenter's son says, "But I say to you." Jesus doesn't point to scripture to say, "Well, I can say it because." He doesn't point to the temple and say, "I can say it because." He doesn't point to the priest. He doesn't point to tradition. He doesn't point to anything besides himself as justification for that amazing phrase, "But I say to you." And this is something we can never, ever forget as Christians, even now, 2,000 years later. Bishop Holder said that the church alone cannot save a person. Just walking through the door does not automatically save you. I've been writing newsletter articles for about a year now, all about the Bible, and that it has to be read with a little grain of skepticism, because the Bible is not the unerring word of God that comes down infallible, that it has to be interpreted. We have to have a relationship with Jesus, and it's not going to be given to you if we don't put in the time and the effort. This is exactly what Paul was talking about in his letter to the church in the city of Corinth. These are people who had never met Jesus in person, and yet Paul is still talking about a faith in a Christian's relationship with Jesus. You know, it wasn't expected, natural, or easy for those people at the Sermon on the Mount to accept the authority of this wandering preacher from Galilee just because they saw him with their eyes in person. Seeing Jesus didn't make it automatic that they would be able to accept this audacious proposal when he simply says, "But I say to you." So the people in Corinth are at no real disadvantage. Their willingness to believe when Jesus says, "But I say to you," is of that same nature as those people listening in person on the Sermon on the Mount. They have to be willing to be open to Jesus. They have to give Jesus the chance to speak to them against everything that they knew was right. They have to let Jesus in and say, but take another look at it because I say to you. And then they have to actively follow Jesus. And that means that we're no different. 2,000 years has not separated us from that commitment of faith that the people at the Sermon on the Mount had to make, the people in Corinth had to make, and that we have to make, is that do we really sincerely believe it when Jesus says, but I say to you. And all of this is what Paul today calls God's wisdom. This isn't a school of wisdom. This is the wisdom of the Spirit, he says. The Spirit, says Paul, searches everything, even down into the depths of God himself. The Spirit, in other words, is the unity of the Trinity, and the Spirit is what keeps us and Jesus and each other connected. The Spirit is our relationship. The Spirit is what allows faith to always be a community. And since we don't have the chance to stand on the mountainside with Jesus, it is the Spirit who helps us to feel near to him and to believe when Jesus says, but I say to you. Jesus is not a person who can be locked into a particular formula, into a particular institution, into a particular book. With Jesus, there is always the possibility. There always will be a surprise. And as believers, it is up to us to build a relationship that is strong enough to hear and to listen and to follow when even today, Jesus says, but I say to you. Today is the first Sunday, as I said, of pre-Lent. This is the beginning of our remote preparations for the absolute, unbelievable, astounding surprise that our God is going to die on the cross. No one could have been prepared for that. And if we really try to understand the cross, no one today can really be prepared for that. We have to understand that ours is a God of surprises. We need to realize that Jesus died not only to fulfill our later theology of forgiveness of sins. This is the church looking back at the unspeakable scandal of the cross and seeking purpose. And it's very true that it's the forgiveness of sins, but Jesus wasn't put on the cross because Pilate said, well, he's going to forgive somebody's sins. Jesus was condemned to die because he was an affront to the ways of power, to the ways of tradition, and even to our understanding of the sacred. This means that we have to look for Jesus always in the now. What his is, but I say to you, is meant for us today. And what does he mean by I say to you today, to each of us as individuals and to each of us as part of the holy name of Jesus? We'll never know without giving him the chance to speak to us and for us to listen and to follow. So may these days, beginning today and the first Sunday of pre-Lent, the ones that lead up to that unbelievable mystery of the cross, may they give us the opportunity to listen for Jesus's, but I say to you. And for this we pray in his most holy of names. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord, as we gather on this day, with all joking aside, there is an awful lot of snow coming this week, and we do pray for safety for those who have to travel to work or those who will be traveling. We pray for all of those who will be cleaning driveways and that they all be able to stay healthy. We ask you, Lord, to watch over us at these special times. We also offer our prayers, Lord, in memory of Betty Barczynski, who passed away this past week. She was a wonderful neighbor, and this is offered by Teresa Belisle. We also offer prayers to that same woman, Elizabeth Betty Barczynski, as offered by her nephew, John Sidge. We offer our prayers at this time for Brandy Clements, for whom we have been praying for quite a while, who was battling cancer. She passed away this past week, and we offer prayers on her behalf that she may rest in peace. We also offer prayers for her family, that they may know of your gift of faith and of hope. We continue to pray for Liz Richmond, who is battling cancer and raising three young girls on her own, Alex, a 16-year-old with lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, and Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer. It's all offered by Cindy Benjamin. We offer prayers for Frank Skrosky, offered by Brother Don, the Skrosky Gates and Kirkendall families. I offer prayers for Bishop Thomas Canas' continued health and well-being, and also that of his wife, Catherine. We also pray for following all battling cancer, Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Skrosky, Fathers Ray Drada and Maurice Lazell as offered by myself, Richard Poe as offered by the Poe and Foster families, and 2-year-old Jack Saleh as offered by
Mariana Foster. Are there any prayers that you would like to offer for the congregation today? And no, I can't pray for no snow. Okay. For all these prayers, Lord, plus the private ones that we now bring before you, and also, Lord, we ask you to bless each and every one of us here gathered, and also those of our parish who are unable to be with us today, those who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord. May she rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he arose again in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Those who keep his commandments remain in him, and he in them. And the way we know that he remains in us is from the Spirit that he has shared with all of us. Most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, with the same faith and trust as did the apostles and disciples of your Son and our Savior, when he said to them, I myself will bring bread to them.
Thank you.
offering, most holy Trinity, which we make, in remembrance of the passion, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ, in honor of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, that it may add to their honor and aid our salvation. May they, whose memory we honor on earth, intercede for us in heaven. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be accepted to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Lord our God, accept our offering and make us worthy in your sight. Grant us that righteousness which is given through faith in your Son, Jesus. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Give us this season of anticipation that takes us from the joy of your incarnation to the penitential mood of fasting and the contemplation of your passion. As we prepare to abstain from worldly trappings, open our hearts and our minds to a spirit of true contrition and of loving reverence for you. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and life, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide her throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. Congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love. Wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of those. We are the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles and with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life in his most precious blood. Just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world, and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment, when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever, and the bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, with the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those whom he loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me I would have in my company, for I am to see this glory of mine which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words of the archpriestly prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we, your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask, O Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those that are in life straight in the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching, and following divine example, we say with confidence,
Our Father, who art in heaven,
And by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together with your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our day, supported by the help of your mercy, that we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same, Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be caused by judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me tidy with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has rendered unto me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, who comes to take away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to speak to you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Body and the blood of Christ.
the blood of Christ. The body and 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 the blood of Christ. The body.
Bless the Lord. most holy Trinity, grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you, through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory be to you, Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life. Life for the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, the darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God who came as a witness to testify to the light, that all through him may believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into his world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, and his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's holiness, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.